All right, guys. The name of this sermon is going to be called Biggie Smalls. Biggie Smalls. And before I really start to explain what it's about, let me just kind of give you a recap of what's been going on. This sermon is basically a continuation of a series I've been doing. It's just that I'm just now realizing that I've been doing a series, but it's a series on the word little, and so I'm calling it the Little Series. And of course, the title of this sermon, Biggie Smalls, doesn't have the word little in it, but it has the word small and little can mean the same thing. And so I have this sermon, and then earlier this month I had a sermon called A Little of a Lot. And I was talking about Abraham and his friend Lot in the Bible, and I was basically just talking about how if we're not careful, we may have a lot in our life holding us back, that one little person being a lot. In other words, that one little person, that one leaven will ruin the whole lump. It'll just ruin it all. If we're not careful, if we're not quick to detach ourselves from people that could really ruin blessings that God wants to give us, but he may not give it to us until we detach from that one little person, that one lot, that even though they seem like a little issue, really, they're really a big issue. They're a lot to have to deal with and a lot to have to answer for when you end up empty-handed and not receiving your blessings because you didn't depart from that person. And so at the beginning of this year, my New Year's sermon to kick off this new year, the name of it was, It's the Little Things in Life. And I was just talking about how sometimes the little blessings, the little things can sometimes turn out to be the biggest blessings. And I also explained that sometimes it's what we call the little people. And by little, I just mean people that are often overlooked, people that are considered irrelevant, obsolete, you know, unnecessary. Sometimes these types of people can end up being key people to help you move forward into what God has for you. They can be the main people that will open the door, help open the door for you to walk through into your destiny, to walk through great opportunities for this year. So don't overlook the little people just because everyone else overlooks them and doesn't think much of them. Be good to everybody. Be fair and act rightly towards any and everybody. Don't be a respecter of persons is what it all comes down to, because to do so could be to cause you to miss out on your own blessings. And so with that said, let me tell you what this message is about, Biggie Smalls. This message is basically saying this. There may be some of you listening right now, and you may feel like you are a little person or a small person. You might be thinking, well, okay, I understood what you were saying at the beginning of the year about, you know, being good to the little people, but I feel like a little person in the eyes of the majority. I feel like I'm not much in the eyes of most people, like I'm nothing amongst the masses, like I could just be lost in the crowd and I wouldn't stand out at all. I just don't feel like much at all. I don't feel like I can make much of a difference. I'm still trying to figure out what the purpose of my life is. I just feel like I'm just out here floating around. I feel small myself. And so what this sermon serves to do is to basically just give you words of encouragement, to show you something. And what I want to show you is that even though you may feel small, you must understand that sometimes you have advantages by being the small guy, the small fry, as some people would probably call you. Sometimes you can accomplish very big things that others can't accomplish because you go by unnoticed and overlooked. You do things And people, because they overlook you, listen, you can find ways to do certain things that by the time you get done with it, it will be too late for people to try to ruin things for you because they weren't paying any attention to you from Jump Street. You understand what I'm saying? So there are advantages to being the small fry. And so what I want to do is I want to start out in the book of Proverbs, chapter 30. And there's five verses that I want to look at, starting at verse 24. And four of these five verses, every one of them explains a different creature. It lists four different creatures, one in every of these four verses. And it explains that even though these little critters are small, they're little, they still do big and amazing things. They have a lot of potential because of their size. Hence the name of this sermon, Biggie Smalls. You may be small, but maybe you're big after all. Get it? So I'm using these critters to show you how you should view yourself, how you view other people that are considered small as well. And just to help some people out, if anybody is listening who may also be following along in the word, just to let you know, this will definitely be a page turner. So, but just to give you a heads up, I will continuously go back and forth to this area here in Proverbs. So if you're following along, it may be a good idea to grab a bookmark and just, you know, put something here in this spot here in Proverbs. So that way when I leave to go to other verses and then I come back to Proverbs to reference these verses again, you can easily flip back here to Proverbs chapter 30. So looking at verses 24 through 28, it says this: "There be four things which are little upon the earth, but they are exceeding wise. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their meat in the summer. The conies are but a feeble folk, yet make they their houses in the rocks. The locusts have no king, yet go they forth, all of them, by bands. The spider taketh hold with her hands and is in kings' palaces." So let's go back to verse 24 and let's look at each verse bit by bit. Let's break it down. Verse 24 again says this: "There be four things which are little upon the earth, but they are exceeding wise." Let me just stop and say this before I move on. I want you to understand that just because you may be little or small in the eyes of most, that does not necessarily make you stupid. Small does not have to equal stupid or being an idiot. Because there are some people that feel like if they're nothing in the eyes of people, listen, folks won't even have to belittle you. Sometimes you'll feel like an idiot on your own. You will belittle your own self. Oh, well, people don't like me. They don't think much of me. So then you start thinking little of yourself. Just because you might not be much to most people, it doesn't mean that you're foolish or that you're irrelevant or that you're nothing. You can actually be exceeding wise, as it says here in this verse, because there are creatures that even though they're small, they are very, very wise. Also, let me say this: if you're somebody who's from a small town, you must understand that, listen, just because you come from a small town, that does not mean that you have to have a limited amount of knowledge or that, listen, how much you use your brain must be limited, that you have to play dumb to fit in, to belong, to play the small town mindset role, stereotype that is expected of you. Many times people come from small towns and they want to automatically think that they can't really amount to anything in life and that they can't achieve much of anything, or they feel like in order for them to achieve big things, they have to move into a bigger town or a city. And sometimes that very well may be the case. You may have to relocate, but at the same time, you must understand that there's also the possibility that God has placed you in the small town to make a big difference, to be a Biggie Smalls. So you may be small in a small town, but you don't have to have a small town mindset. So what if it causes you to not fit in? Maybe God didn't create you to blend in and fit in and act like a clone. Maybe you're supposed to stand out and, listen, cause others to think outside of the box and do something amazing. So I just wanted to share that, but let's continue on. Verse 25 says this: the ants are a people not strong. And I just wanted to point out that I find it cool that the Bible calls ants people. And that helps you understand why I want to use these critters, these creatures, to help you view how you should look at yourself and even other humans, other people who are considered little, because that's how the Bible is going about this, comparing them to people almost. So it says this: the ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their meat in the summer. They may be little and they may not be that strong, but with the strength and the integrity that they do have and the drive and the motivation that they do have, they make preparations to get the job done, to go and get what they need. And so with that said, let me say this: you may feel small, you may feel weak, you might not feel that strong, but with the energy that you do have, simply do the best that you can to, listen, step out on faith and make certain preparations. And what I mean by that is this: as long as you stay in the faith and not let too much doubt sink in, what begins to happen is God will help make provision for you, provisions for your needs. And so the more you have faith and the more you prepare yourself for what it is that he has for you to do, he will continue to make provisions for what he is asking of you. Regardless of how small you are, he will meet the need and make up for what you lack in strength. Go with me real quick to Exodus chapter 16. Starting at verse 14, and we know what's going on here. We have this moment where God has used Moses to help the Hebrews get out of slavery from the Egyptians. We know how that story played out. God used Moses to set his people free, but on their way to the promised land, they're out traveling in the wilderness, and God begins to provide for them. But they, of course, had to make certain preparations. They had to step out on faith and go about things a certain way. And so let's start here at verse 14. It says this: and when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness, there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoar frost on the ground. And when the children of Israel saw it, they said one to another, it is manna, for they wist not what it was. And Moses said unto them, this is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. So Moses is letting the people know, this bread that you see from heaven, this stuff that you call manna because you don't know what it is, this is from God. In other words, this is your provision. He's providing for you as you step out on faith on your way to the promised land. It says this: this is the thing which the Lord hath commanded, gather of it every man according to his eating, an omer for every man according to the number of your persons. Take ye every man for them which are in his tents. And the children of Israel did so, and gathered some more, some less. And when they did meet it with an omer, he that gathered much had nothing over, and he that gathered little had no lack. They gathered every man according to his eating. And Moses said, let no man leave of it till the morning. Notwithstanding, they hearkened not unto Moses, but some of them left of it until the morning, and it bred worms and stank, and Moses was wroth with them. So what has happened here is this. The manna has come down. They've gone out to collect this manna, and they've based it off of how many people are in tents. In other words, if you have a lot of people in your camp, that's more manna you get. If you don't have very many people, you get a little bit less, but we're making sure that there's enough for everybody, that everybody gets the amount that they need. But it is said to not leave any left over, because if you leave it over, hanging out overnight in the morning, it will smell bad, it will spoil. But there are some people that don't take heed. They let it sit out overnight and it spoils, and it makes Moses mad. But now watch what they do next. Verse 21. It says this, and they gathered it every morning, every man according to his eating. And when the sun waxed hot, it melted. And it came to pass that on the sixth day they gathered twice as much bread, 2 omers for one man. And all the rulers of the congregation came and told Moses. And he said unto them, this is that which the Lord hath said. Tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Bake that which ye will bake today, and seethe that ye will seethe, and that which remaineth over lay up for you to be kept until the morning. And they laid it up till the morning as Moses bade, and it did not stink, neither was there any worm therein. And Moses said, eat that today, for today is a Sabbath unto the Lord. Today ye shall not find it in the field. 6 days ye shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath, in it there shall be none. And it came to pass, there went out some of the people on the seventh day for to gather, and they found none. So every day they were supposed to go out at a certain time during the morning. The manna was going to fall. They were supposed to go out and gather it so that they can have something to eat on. They weren't supposed to leave any left over. Some people did it. It spoiled, and it made Moses angry. But then what happened was this. As it got close to the end of the week, on the sixth day, they were actually supposed to go out and get twice as much as what they had done on the previous days. Why? Because, listen, on the seventh day, that Sabbath day, it was supposed to be a day of rest. God did not want them to go out and collect manna. He didn't want them to do any special fancy works. He wanted them to chill out. So since he was going to want them to chill out on that day, he said the day before that, the day before the last day, the sixth day, collect twice as much. So you have some for that day and the Sabbath day. But check this out. On this particular day, the sixth day, when you go and you collect double the amount, I'm going to make sure that the bit that you have left over that you don't eat because you're saving it for the next day, I'm going to make sure that it does not spoil over, that it will stay fresh for that next day, right? So for this particular day, I'm going to make sure it stays fresh. So you would have thought people would have been like, okay, well, let me go on and go out here and get my double portion. But instead, they decided to go out that seventh day, even though they were told it's not going to happen. And they went out on the Sabbath day looking around, and there was no manna for them to collect. So one minute, they get manna, and they leave some left over, which they weren't supposed to. And now when they're supposed to have some left over, they don't. It's important to be willing to prepare for the provision. As he provides to you, continue to go about things the right way so that you can continue to receive the provision. Now look at this with me real quick to help get the point across of what to do, because I was showing you with that example of what not to do. But look at this of what to do in the book of Ruth chapter 2. We see in verses 2 and 3, it says this, "And Ruth the Moabitess said unto Naomi, let me now go to the field and glean ears of corn after him in whose sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, go, my daughter. And she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And her hap was to light on a part of the field belonging unto Boaz, who was of the kindred of Elimelech." So in this story, what plays out in the first chapter is you have Naomi. She's lost some family members. She decides to go back home to her homeland. And you have her daughter-in-law, Ruth, who decides that she wants to tag along because she doesn't want to leave her alone. She doesn't want to leave her hanging. And she feels like she doesn't really have much going for herself. So she's like, I'm going to go with you. So she goes on this adventure with her. And when they get to this place, Ruth decides to go gleaning. She decides to go out into the field and go after ears of corn to bring back home. So now skip down to 15 and look at this. It says, "And when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and reproach her not. And let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her, and leave them, that she may glean them, and rebuke her not. So she gleaned in the field until even, and beat out that she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley." So not only is she stepping out on faith and gleaning in this field that is totally new to her, check this out. She ends up finding favor with this guy named Boaz, who is the owner of this particular field that she's in. She could have got in trouble, but she didn't. In fact, she finds favor even so much to the point where Boaz tells the men who had already been gleaning in the field for who knows how long. He says to them, listen, when you guys go out to go after this harvest, to collect this stuff out of the field, this produce, when you're out there doing this, as you're moving forward, collecting, purposely let a little bit of what you collect kind of fall off to the side. Let some handfuls fall out of your hand here and there. Leave them behind so that when Ruth comes up behind you to get what she can get, she'll have some things to pick up. Just kind of, you know, act like, you know, it's an accident. Just kind of leave some stuff behind so that she can have some things to pick up. And don't rebuke her. Don't wag your finger at her. Don't belittle her. Don't question her and say, who do you think you are? What do you think you're doing here? Because this isn't your territory. It's mine. It's my field. Do this my way. I'm going to allow her to be blessed. And so this is what I'm saying to you. This is the type of favor you'll receive as you prepare for the provision. And she even found such a favor with Boaz that in chapter 4, the last chapter of this particular book, Boaz ends up marrying her. We see that proposal is made to marry her. And so she marries into way more than what she originally had, all because she was willing to continue to go pursue something that was all new to her, but she was willing to take her chances. And so that's what I want to show you when it comes to making the preparation. You know, one time this guy at this church that I used to go to, he was talking, he was doing I think it was a Wednesday night Bible study, and he was talking about some things, and he was talking about how, you know, he was really upset because he was struggling to provide for his family because he wasn't making a whole lot of money, and there was this church that was giving out food on a particular day every week, and God had put it on his heart to go to this church, you know, and go stand in the line and, you know, get some food. And at first he didn't want to do it because he felt so ashamed to have to go stand in line for food to be given to him, because to him it was almost like it made him feel like less of a man, because he felt like he should be able to provide for his family without having that struggle. But God was like, no, go ahead. And so finally, around Thanksgiving time, he said he went and stood in that line, and it just so happened to be during the time where they have even more food than usual to give out, which not a surprise since it's around Thanksgiving time. And he was talking about how they were giving out turkeys and all kinds of stuff, and he had, you know, such an abundance to take home to his family that the food just lasted for days and days, and he felt so blessed. But he just had to just kind of have some faith and just make the preparation for the provision. You know, he didn't feel very strong. He didn't feel like he was much of a man anymore. Probably how the ants feel at times. Like, I'm not much and I feel weak. I don't feel very strong. But if I just keep on going, I know that I will get the provision. So just something to consider. Continue to rely on God for your needs when you just don't feel strong, when you feel too small. With that said, go with me back to Proverbs so that we can look at the next verse, verse 26. It says this: the conies are but a feeble folk, yet make they their houses in the rocks. This one I'm going to really have fun with. It's saying that these creatures called conies, they're feeble. You know, they need protection because it doesn't take much to break them down. They're little and they're feeble. They're fragile. Or fragile, as the man said in that movie, A Christmas Story. Fragile. I think it's French. No, I think it's fragile. But they make their houses in the rocks. In other words, even though they know they're feeble, to make up for it, they make sure that their home is in a place of security. Their home is in the rocks. Their home is in a place where they have these hard rocks of shelter protecting them. And so I want to use this to get a point across, and it's this. Everybody needs to do what they can to have a home. And when I say a home, I mean their home is in their house or apartment, their household, and also a church home as well. We need homes where we can feel safe and protected. And you may say, well, I can't control what goes on in the outside world. Somebody might try to break into my house or something. That's not what I mean. I mean more so what's going on the inside of your home. Because sometimes we have things going on the inside of our personal homes or even church homes that really break us down and make us feeble and weak, whether it be physically, emotionally, spiritually. So just like how the conies make sure that they, even though they're feeble, they make sure that their home, their place of rest, is a place where they really can rest and feel protected. We have to feel the same way inside our own home and in our church home. And if not, it's important to do what we can, if possible, to make the adjustments in our home and in our church home so that we can feel safe. Or even if it means, you know, going to, you know, having a new church home, trying out new churches, you know, but be, you know, or having somebody move out or you move out into a different home or apartment or, you know, whatever. But it's important to have that safety within your home. And a godly atmosphere within your home and your church, because sometimes, unfortunately, some churches don't really have that godly atmosphere because it's not about God anymore. It's about people. It's about things. We've made it be about everything except for God because we've set idols up, whether it be in our homes or in our church homes, and it's just not about God anymore. And so it causes a lot of chaos. It causes a lot of grief, a lot of heartache for people. It causes division. It causes people to come up against one another in ways that just aren't good. And so it's one thing to have trouble in the outside world, but when you're feeble, you want to make sure that within your home and within your church home, you have a safe haven to protect your feeble self. And so with that said, go with me to 1 Samuel. Look at this with me. 1 Samuel chapter 18, starting at, I'll start at the beginning here. Just looking at the first couple of verses, it says this: "And it came to pass when he had made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him go no more home to his father's house." So what's going on here is this: you have David. We know who David is. David, he was the one that took out Goliath, and he helped King Saul and the Israelites come up against the Philistines and defeat the giant Goliath. But the thing about David was that he had went through a lot of rejection. People overlooked him. They didn't think much of him. He was rejected by his father Jesse. His brothers didn't think much of him. And so when he has this big victory, people began to acknowledge him for his talents, for his abilities, for his love of God. And so what ends up happening is, you know, him and Jonathan have a special connection, and Saul, King Saul, decides to take David in his own home. He doesn't want David to go back to his father's house. So you would think this is an opportunity. This is a time for David to feel loved, to feel wanted, to feel like he belongs. But if you go down right here, still in the same chapter, you go down to some verses, down to verse 10, look at what happens. Just verses after he's welcomed into Saul's home, it says this: "And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied in the midst of the house. And David played with his hand as at other times, and there was a javelin in Saul's hand. And Saul cast the javelin, for he said, I will smite David even to the wall with it. And David avoided out of his presence twice, and Saul was afraid of David, because the Lord was with him and was departed from Saul." So, one moment, at the beginning of a verse, we see David welcomed into Saul's home. Saul is just loving on him like he's his own son. And then, just verses later, in the very same chapter, the same Saul is trying to kill the same David. The same David he took in as his own son. David didn't do anything wrong. But because of the issues, the personal issues and insecurities that Saul had, on top of this evil spirit having his way within Saul, Saul decides to start throwing javelins, these spears, at David, trying to attack him. And so David has to flee from his presence. And so I just want to say, if you're not careful, these are the types of things that can play out in your home or in your church home. You'll have people who, listen, they'll be welcoming to you when you move into a new place or when you start attending a new church. They may be welcoming to you, and you may feel the most welcome you've been in a while anywhere. And then next thing you know, the same people who it seemed like they took you in and loved on you will be the main ones that, when you least expect it out of nowhere, it's like they come at you causing you trouble, getting you to a place where you start second guessing some things. You start thinking, well, man, should I have come here? Do I need to leave? You know, what's going to be my fate if I stick around here? You know, am I misunderstanding something? Did I do something wrong? What did I do? I hadn't even been here that long. What's going on? But then you have to also acknowledge this, that when certain things like this go by unchecked, and especially in your personal household, it can become a generational thing where later on other family members start having these same issues. If you would, go with me to 2 Samuel now, looking at chapter 13. Starting at the beginning, it says this: "And it came to pass after this that Absalom, the son of David, had a fair sister whose name was Tamar. And Amnon was the son, and Amnon, the son of David, loved her." So David, this same David I just got done talking about, David has some children. He has a son named Absalom, a son named Amnon, and a daughter named Tamar. So now let's look at this verse 2. And Amnon was vexed that he fell sick for his sister Tamar, for she was a virgin. And Amnon thought it hard for him to do anything to her. So Amnon has a very, very, very not so good crush on his own sister, to the point where it's driving him crazy. He's just driven wild with lust for his sister. Verse 3, but Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimea, David's brother. And Jonadab was a very subtle man. And here we are looking at this subtle word again. It just keeps popping up, don't it? I did a sermon, a last sermon that I did last week, where I was, the name of the sermon was A Perfect Circle. And I was talking about the disciples, the different disciples of Jesus. But I paused from talking about the disciples to talking about Jacob from the Bible, and how he had been a trickster and a supplanter and a heel catcher, and he had basically schemed his brother Esau out of his birthright. And it was said of him that he was very subtle. It was said by Jacob's own father that he had tricked him into praying over him and giving over the inheritance to him that his brother Esau was supposed to have. He pretended to be his brother to get the blessing from the father. And so when the father finds out, he's like, oh, he was subtle. It was right for his name to be Jacob, because that's what his name means, to be a trickster. And I was also referencing how in Genesis, in the beginning of the Bible, we see how things played out with Adam and Eve, and how it said that the serpent was the most subtle beast of the field. And so we see here that Amnon had a friend named Jonadab, who was a subtle man. So evidently, we see right off the bat that this Jonadab is somebody who must have a habit of talking somebody into doing something that they don't need to be doing. Because every time we come across somebody subtle in the Bible, oftentimes it seems like they're fixing to get ready to do something. They're fixing to get ready to scheme and cause some trickery and try to talk people into doing some stuff that they shouldn't. And sure enough, let's look at what happens. Verse 4, it says, and he said unto him, why art thou being the king's son lean from day to day? Wilt thou not tell me? And Amnon said unto him, I love Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister. And Jonadab said unto him, lay thee down on thy bed and make thyself sick. And when thy father cometh to see thee, say unto him, I pray thee, let my sister Tamar come and give me meat and dress the meat in my sight that I may see it and eat it at her hand. And so sure enough, he's being subtle, all right. He's being sneaky and cunning and clever in a sly and deceitful way. Jonadab talks Amnon into basically raping his sister. He's saying, listen, you're the son of a king. Why in the world would you sit back and want when you can just have whatever it is that you want? You've got power. Take advantage of your power, of your position. You can get away with whatever you want. So here's the plan. You should act like you're sick, be in bed, send for your sister Tamar, have her come and cook some stuff up for you. And when you get her alone, it's your moment to take advantage of her. And so I just want to ask some people listening, is this the type of stuff that goes on in your household or in your church home? Do you have these issues of people being like the serpent, who is subtle, who always is trying to talk somebody into doing things that they ought not to do, always coming up like a snake hissing in somebody's ear, trying to talk them into doing things that they know God has already said, you better not do it. You better not do it or there's going to be trouble. You better not do it or there's going to be consequences. Do you have that serpent always in somebody's ear, starting trouble, getting stuff stirred up, stirring up the pot? Do you have moments like this where you have someone like a Tamar, someone who enters into the household or listen, the church house, who listen? They're trying their best to live right. They're trying to be holy. And I say that because, you know, it says that Tamar was a virgin, but obviously we know what that means. But virginity also represents in the Bible pureness and holiness. And so do you have people that are like Tamar? They're innocent folk. They're just coming in. They're just trying to do their own thing and live right. And it seems like people make game, make sport out of the Tamars and say, well, let me see what I can do. Let me take advantage of his or her kindness. Let me mistake their kindness for weakness, and let me take advantage of the fact that they're nice and the fact that they want to just get along and just not cause trouble. Let me see how I can take advantage of them. Let me see how far I can take things and ruin things. Let me try to take advantage and see what I can get out of this person. These are things that have to be dealt with. So now let's keep going. Verse 6 says, so Amnon lay down and made himself sick. And when the king was come to see him, Amnon said unto the king, I pray thee, let Tamar my sister come and make me a couple of cakes in my sight, that I may eat at her hand. Then David sent home to Tamar, saying, go now to thy brother Amnon's house and dress him meat. David, he doesn't know what's going on. He doesn't know that he's been used as a go-to to go fetch after Tamar, and that Tamar is really being led into a trap. Let me ask you, is this the type of stuff that happens within your home, that happens within the church walls? Do you have people that they do stuff like what Amnon did, where they pretend to be sick? In other words, listen, oh goodness, listen, you have people that really will have problems. They'll have troubles. They'll have illness and disease. They'll have some type of affliction or a type of bondage, and they really need help. But the problem is, you'll have somebody who all they want to do is pretend that something's wrong, pretend that they have a problem, not because they have real problems, but because they have to have the spotlight on them at all times. And so they take advantage and they keep constantly making things about them, wanting everyone to throw the pity party for them all the time, when it really doesn't take a rocket science to see that there's really not much wrong. And so these people that pretend to need this and need that, what they do is, behind the scenes, they take advantage of the Tamars. They take advantage of those who really could use some help or use some assistance. They take advantage and prey on those who, listen, they're scared might take over the spotlight or might have the spotlight on them for just a moment. So if I can come and ruin things for this person, if I can come and damage this person, if I can go and wound this person, this will make things better for me, because they'll be just like everyone else, and I can keep the spotlight on myself. Even in the household, we will have people that do things like this. Siblings that take advantage of other siblings, want to, listen, to rape people in the family, molest younger people in the family. And you'll have people that will know it and can do something about it and won't do jack squat about it. Or it can even be physical abuse that goes on in the household, and people don't want to report it because they don't want somebody else in the family to be offended, because As I explained in one of my last messages, when it comes to family, you offend one, you offend them all. So now everybody else in the family or in the household will have to set their face up against you because you stood up for somebody when really it was a convenience for everybody to sit around in the living room acting like nothing's a big deal and nothing went on. Acting like the mama didn't get punched and the kid didn't get smacked around and the cat didn't get thrown upside the wall. But listen, there comes a point where the chaos has to cease so that you can have rest with your little feeble self. But let's keep going. Verse 8, it says, so Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house, and he was laid down, and she took flour and kneaded it, and made cakes in his sight, and did bake the cakes. And she took a pan and poured them out before him, but he refused to eat. And Amnon said, have out all men from me. And they went out every man from him. So while Tamar is cooking some stuff up for her brother, Amnon is watching, waiting like a snake ready to strike. And he's ordering all the people out. In other words, he's making sure that he doesn't leave evidence behind, that he doesn't, listen, have any witnesses to see what it is that he's going to do. He shoos everyone away so that he can do this dirty deed. And I just want to know, do you have people in the household or within the church walls that would do these things, that they'll have a Tamar in their life who loves to serve and who loves to be involved in this and in that, this church matter, that church matter, or loves to help out with stuff within the household, doesn't mind cooking, doesn't mind fixing stuff around the house, doesn't mind cleaning up the house, doesn't mind doing this, doesn't mind doing that, running to the store, doing this and that. And the whole time that the quote-unquote Tamar is helping out and being a part of this church committee and being a part of that household activity, doing this and that, being of help, not expecting a lot in return, just happy to help out, do you then have people that are like Amnon's, who all they want to do is watch and wait for the perfect time to strike? We'll sit there and watch Tamar do this and do that and do this and do that, and then have the nerve to do the Tamar wrong. Take advantage of the Tamar while watching the Tamar give her all. Do you have this type of stuff happening? Do you see these things happen? Does this happen to you where it seems like no matter what you do, you end up having to learn the hard way that you're used, that you're just being taken advantage of because of your good nature? There has to come a point where you have to make some changes within the household and put a stop to things going on within the church walls. But let's look at this. Verse 10. And Amnon said unto Tamar, bring the meat into the chamber that I may eat of thine hand. And Tamar took the cakes which she had made and brought them into the chamber to Amnon. This very much makes me think of the story of Jesus and Judas. Judas was the one that betrayed Jesus. Jesus, they were sitting around eating, Jesus and his disciples, and Jesus said, hey, someone's going to betray me. And the one that was going to betray him was the very one that he was sitting there feeding. Isn't it crazy how, as Tamar is going over to the bed to go feed her brother, it's the moment that her brother betrays her. How much longer will you put up with people who continuously betray you? When you need them the most, it seems like they stab you in the back. Whether it be in the household or the church house, we must not be in a place of timidity where we're too timid, too afraid to speak up, stand out for ourselves, or to be too afraid to get up and leave and not allow ourselves to constantly be done wrong by the very ones that we try to feed and nourish and help. Let's look at this. And when she had brought them, verse 11, unto him to eat, he took hold of her and said unto her, come lie with me, my sister. And she answered him, nay, my brother, do not force me, for no such thing ought to be done in Israel. Do not thou this folly. And whither shall I cause my shame to go? And as for thee, thou shalt be as one of the fools in Israel. Now, therefore, I pray thee, speak unto the king, for he will not withhold me from thee. Howbeit, he would not hearken unto her voice, but being stronger than she, forced her and lay with her. Tamar is little. She's feeble compared to Amnon. So Amnon takes advantage. Verse 15, then Amnon hated her exceedingly. Isn't it crazy how one moment he has a wild lust for his sister, and then after committing the terrible act against her, now he hates her? And with that said, we have to be careful what we tolerate. This is why it's important that when you feel little and you feel feeble, you must make sure that even though you may not be able to deal, or listen, you may not be able to control what goes on the outside world, within your household and within your church walls, you must make sure that you can feel safe and secure, because when you continue to see the warning signs and there's a buildup and you see the snakes in position to strike, you must be quick and hasty to exit. You may have had some good times. You may have had some fun moments. But listen, sticking around for a few good folks that are good to you, just to allow yourself to be done wrong time and time again, will really cause damage. You're just allowing more venom to be injected into you. And then after you're taken advantage of so much, some of the same people that took advantage of you will be the ones to turn around and hate you exceedingly. Remember, when I was still in Proverbs, I talked about how it said that, you know, in verse 24, these creatures, they may be small, but they are exceeding wise. You have to be exceedingly wise to avoid the exceeding hatred, oh goodness, that comes up against you. Listen, in other words, you don't have to play dumb. Don't let anybody make you feel like, if you acknowledge the reality that you're being done wrong, that makes you less of a Christian, and that in order to be more of a Christian, you have to tolerate the betrayals and the abuse and the hatred and the jealousy that comes up against you. You can dismiss yourself. You can speak out and speak up. You have to be exceeding wise when you're small and feeble, and you're not that strong compared to others. Use your brain over brawn, as they say. Use your brains and be exceeding wise to escape the exceeding hatred of the Amnons. But continuing on in verse 15, it says, listen, then Amnon hated her exceedingly, so that the hatred wherewith he hated her was greater than the love wherewith he had loved her. He hates her more than he once loved her now. It says, and Amnon said unto her, arise, be gone. So before Amnon, or before Tamar gets a chance to dismiss herself, Amnon uses her, starts to hate her, and dismisses her. her himself. So she is now booted out of his living quarters. Verse 16 says, and she said unto him, there is no cause. This evil in sending me away is greater than the other that thou didst unto me. But he would not hearken unto her. She's trying to get him to see what you're doing now. Shooing me away as if I'm nothing is bad, just like when you just got done taking advantage of me just now. But he didn't want to listen. So now she has been double wronged. She's been used up and now pushed aside, set aside like a toy, put away on a shelf after being played with. Verse 17, then he called his servant that ministered unto him and said, put now this woman out from me, and bolt the door after her. So now he's setting it up to where she cannot even return. And look at this. And she had a garment of diverse colors upon her, for with such robes were the king's daughters that were virgins appareled. Then his servant brought her out and bolted the door after her. And Tamar put ashes on her head and rent her garment of diverse colors that was on her and laid her hand on her head and went on crying. So now we see what has happened with Tamar is she has this outfit of diverse colors, this robe of diverse colors. And it makes me think of the story of Joseph in the Bible, who had a coat of many colors. Joseph, he had brothers, but Joseph was favored by his dad and was favored by God. And his dad had made him a special coat of many colors that he didn't make for his other brothers. And his brothers were jealous of him. They were jealous of Joseph's dreams that he was receiving from the Lord. And so they put him in a pit, but they took the coat and dipped it in blood to make it seem as though he had been attacked by an animal. And so there becomes a destruction of his coat of many colors after he was done wrong by his brethren. And right here in this scripture that I'm reading to you, Tamar, also in a situation where she's done wrong by brethren. And so now she tears her garment of diverse colors, of many colors, because of what has been done to her. Her purity has been taken away. No longer a virgin, she destroys her garment of colors representing her purity. And so she's sitting there crying. Now look at this. And Absalom, her brother, said unto her, hath Amnon thy brother been with thee? So Absalom, the other brother, sees his sister in heartache and dismay, and he says, was your brother with you? In other words, he's asking her about what happened. He's saying, did he lie with you? Did he force himself on you? But if you notice, before she can really answer the question, he says, but hold now thy peace, my sister. He is thy brother. Regard not this thing. So Tamar remained desolate in her brother Absalom's house. Now think about this. She's taken advantage of by one brother in a household. She's booted from this household. And then you would think that she would find refuge in her other brother's house. But her other brother tells her to keep quiet and to not stand up for herself about what just happened. And so it says she is left alone, desolate in her brother's house. That's a strong word, desolate. She feels alone, even though she's not the only one in this household. It's her brother's house. So she goes from being taken advantage of in one house to coming to another house where she should also be able to feel safe and secure, but instead she feels even the more so alone. Do you ever find yourself in a household where you're surrounded by other people in the house, yet you still feel alone? You still feel unloved? You still feel ignored? Oh boy. things to consider. Verse 21 says, but when King David heard of all these things, he was very wroth. And Absalom spake unto his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad, for Absalom hated Amnon because he had forced his sister Tamar. So Absalom not only tells Tamar to not say anything, but Absalom decides to not really say anything good or bad to his brother Amnon about what he did to Tamar. He can't stand him, but he just kind of tolerates what has happened. And the crazy thing about it is, if you continue to read, and I'm just going to keep pressing forward to save time, but if you were to continue to read, you would see that 2 years after this rape happens, 2 years later, Absalom finally blows up. He finally can't act okay about it anymore. He finally can't be content about what happened. He just can't hold back. And what he does is, after these 2 years of holding that hatred in for his brother, this anger in for his brother, he blows his top. He comes up with a plan to have his brother Amnon killed. He gets with some men and he says, hey, get him drunk, and when he's merry with wine, hit him, take him out, kill him. Take advantage of him at his weakest. Oh boy. So, just as how Amnon took advantage of Tamar at her weakest, he was taken out at his weakest. At a time where he felt safe, at a time where he had a merry heart, because that was the plan, get him merry with drinking. He is taken out. And you must understand, as I've said, that this is something that, if not dealt with over time, more people in the household, in the church house, take on these issues, almost like generational curses. Spiritually, they just start, these issues start latching on to other people in the next generations to come. David had these issues, and then his children have these household issues that he had. And so there's just continuous treachery, wanting to kill each other, wanting to hurt each other at each other's weakest moments of thinking that everything around us is fine, is okay. These are things that we have to deal with properly so that we can have safe, secure shelter in our households and in our church houses. Let's continue on. Look at this. And where do I want to go to? Joshua 24 verse 15 says this, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. This person is addressing some people and he's saying, listen, whatever you do in your household or in your own personal time with your own personal business and personal affairs, that's your thing. That's your business. Either you'll serve the one true living God or you'll serve some other gods, some false gods, the gods of your fathers. Listen, whatever it is that you decide to do, you do that. But as for me and mine, as for me and my household, we are going to serve the Lord, the one true living God. And so your way of dealing with these household issues, whether it be in your personal house or the church house, you have to have a particular mindset. And the mindset is that we are going to serve the Lord and we're going to have a godly God-fearing, Christ-like atmosphere in this household. We're not going to let the snakes, the serpents, the subtle ones have their way. It's not personal at all, but we've got to be about the Father's business. We cannot let the enemy, the adversary of our souls, the devil, come in, use people, or do things himself, listen, to cause trouble, to get people, listen, pitched against each other in gossip and in slander, in backbiting and backstabbing, stabbing people in the front and the back. You know, coming up against one another, using and abusing and taking advantage of one another, and people being too afraid to do anything about it because they're afraid of what others in the home will think, because they're afraid of, listen, other family members being mad at them when the blood of Jesus is thicker than the blood of your earthly family members, or being afraid to stand up for those being done wrong in the church out of fear of losing some type of fancy little position or a spotlight or a moment on the stage. There has to come a point where people must be willing to love themselves and each other enough to do the right thing. We know what Jesus said. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your being, but listen, also love your neighbor as yourself. We have to love one another. Listen, it can't be just enough to act like you love somebody and care, or act like you care about somebody in front of people. You can't just say around folks, oh, well, you know, I love that person. Oh, I'm good to that person. Oh, I don't have nothing personal against that person. You know, I've always tried to be good to that person and show appreciation to that person and give that person a fair chance and fair opportunity just like everybody else. But deep down in the heart, knowing good and well that that's not true, that that's not the case, that we really didn't show love, true love, and give people fair chances and fair opportunities. Listen, you can't just put on a show for people and behind the scenes do wrong and dirty against certain folks and take advantage of them because you're mistaking their kindness for weakness, or taking advantage of the fact that they're little, so to speak, or feeble, or not as strong as others, or don't have as much power or influence as other people do. It's not okay. If we want to have the true, listen, godly environment and godly love in our homes and in our church homes, we cannot continue to be like Amnons that come up against the Tamars while the Absaloms sit back. Look, being absent like Absaloms. Come on. When it's time to step up and say something, we just stand back and be absent like Absalom. And look, while Tamar is hurting, the Absaloms are, they got a secret hurt. See, that's why the Absaloms want to tell Tamar to be quiet and keep your hurt a secret and don't say nothing, because they're dealing with their own secret hurts, because, listen, they feel less than because they're too afraid to stand up for themselves or for you. And that's why they're afraid to stand up for others, because they haven't quite figured out how to stand up for themselves. And it's almost embarrassing to them because they know deep down that they're at a point in their lives where they should be able to stand up for themselves, but because they can't be themselves, because they feel like they have to put on a show and wear a mask and play a role to belong, listen, because they're still dealing with their own insecure issues that should have been dealt with years upon years ago, when they see the Tamars come in and have their struggles, they don't want the Tamars to speak up. They feel bad about what happened, but they need Tamar to stay quiet, because if Tamar speak out, speaks out. It's a reminder to them, the Absaloms, of how they should have already spoken out for their own selves a long time ago. And so they don't want to be reminded of the progress that they should have already made in their own lives. And so even though they may have a little influence and they may have a little power and they may have a position and they may have a title and they may have a little leeway and they may kind of sort of have their foot in the door just a little bit, just a little more than the Tamars, deep inside, even though they can stand up straight with their chest out and their chin up, deep inside, they still feel feeble and weak and little the way Tamar appears on the outside. What they're seeing with Tamar is how they really feel on the inside. We have to make sure that we have the mindset of, as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. So let's go back to Proverbs. I said I was going to have fun with that one. I did. But moving along, we got to keep going here. Going back to Proverbs chapter 30. Now we're looking at verse 27. It says, the locusts have no king, yet they go forth, all of them, by bands. A locust might not seem like much. A locust being this little a critter that's kind of like a type of a grasshopper, almost, as some people would define a locust. But even though they may seem like a little creature that might not be able to do much harm on its own, locusts, when they come together and they band together and they come together in swarms, oh man, they can be something else. They can be a force to be reckoned with. With that said, if you feel small, just believe and pray that God will send more people like-minded with you that you can band together with. Not necessarily that you need people so much that you need them more than God. You need God more than anybody. But there comes a time when God will put people in your life, whether for a season or for the long haul, who can band together with you to help you walk out your destiny. And so with that said, and they may, like I said, they may also be people considered little people, but they're key people. And so let's go to Matthew chapter 9, starting at verse 35. It says this, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. And if you think about it, what Jesus is basically saying here is this. He sees the people, he's doing things, and he comes across this multitude of these people that they don't really have a leader or you know, a king, so to speak, a leader to lead them, a shepherd to lead the way. And he's comparing them to sheep that don't have a shepherd. They don't know what to do. They're out here fainting. One way of looking at what Jesus said is a saying that we use a lot today, and it's the saying that goes, like a chicken with your head cut off. You probably heard that before. In other words, if you have a chicken and you cut off its head, the body of the chicken might run around for a little while before it finally falls over. And that's kind of like what he's saying about these people. These people that he sees, this multitude of people, are basically like chickens with their heads cut off. Get it? Because they're wandering around. They're just wandering around like the head's been cut off. Get it? The head, because the leader of a group of people can be called the head. Get it? So they're running around like chickens with their heads cut off, because they're people who have no head or no leader, no shepherd. And so because of this, after they've ran around and moved around for a bit, not really knowing what's going on, not knowing what to do, not having any true direction, eventually they faint or they fall over like the chicken's body. See what I did there? But anyway, I thought that was kind of a cool little way of looking at it. But that's what he's saying. And so with that said, let me say this. Many times we get to a place where we feel like we either don't have someone to lead us, a person to really lead us in the right direction, or we may have leadership, but maybe it's not the correct leadership. Maybe we have the wrong people in our lives leading us, or maybe we even have some type of corrupt leadership trying to lead the way, which can also feel like you don't really have a head because the head is loose. Kind of like when people say my screw is loose, they mean something in their head is loose and about to pop off. In other words, something's not right in the head. Get it? So when you don't have the head or the leader or the shepherd, or the screws are loose, so to speak, you have a leadership that's kind of topsy-turvy, they're corrupt, they're not really on the right track. Sometimes when this happens, you'll feel like a chicken with your head cut off. But look at this, verse 37. It says, then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Jesus is saying we need to pray for leaders, for people to come in and listen, go after the harvest. In other words, these people, this multitude is a harvest that's ready to be taken up. And we need laborers, people that want to work and to help with the harvest, to help with the kingdom of God. And this also makes me think of that moment in the Bible where Jesus was talking about how people can be like wolves in sheep's clothing. And so what happens is when the wolves come in, a hireling will just want to go and run and hide. He doesn't really have a desire to stand up for the sheep. But a shepherd, a good shepherd, will stand up for the flock. He will lay his life down for the flock. He'll stay and defend the flock. And so with that said, that's what we need. We need the head. We need the leadership. But at the same time, we don't need just a bunch of hirelings. We don't need people that are in it just for the money. We don't need people in it that are just in it for the fame and the attention and the spotlight and how it can benefit them on a personal level for them. And listen, know in their heart that that's the case, but hide it and try to act as though they care so much about the people. But whenever things get hot and heavy, they're quick to run and hide behind people and tell people of the flock, well, go do this and go do that and come back and tell me what they said and I gotta stay over here. And they'll have a million reasons as to why their hiding is justified and their running from situations is justified, when really it's their opportunity to stand up and stand out amongst the flock and stand up for the flock. We don't need the hirelings. We need true shepherds. And so with that said, like I said, you may feel like a little locust who may not be able to do much on your own. And you may feel a little misguided. You may not know what to do when you're all alone. You feel weak. You just don't know what to do. But pray. Pray for God to guide you. Either, listen, pray that he'll send the someone to guide you and to help you. Or listen, if you can't get the help you need, pray to God, ask him to speak to you and lead you himself. But you got to get to a place where when you get the right direction, as I said, you will link up with other locusts, so to speak, to get the job done. So let's look further so you'll better understand what I'm trying to say. In John chapter 9, starting at verse 12, it says this. And from this forth Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar. When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was the preparation of the Passover and about the sixth hour. And he said unto the Jews, Behold your king. But they cried out, Away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto them, Shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, We have no king but Caesar. This is the moment where they had finally captured Jesus. They had toyed around with him for a while, tortured him a little bit, and they were going to get ready to put him on the cross. And Pilate, who was going to be the one to make the ultimate decision about the fate of people who were always put up to be crucified, he really didn't want to do anything to Jesus. He didn't want to bring Jesus any harm. He felt like Jesus was innocent, but the problem was that Pilate was so scared of the people. He was scared of the crowd. The crowd was getting wild, and they were getting louder and louder with their cheers and jeers of how they wanted Jesus to be done away with. So he's kind of in a limbo, scared, not really sure what to do. He wants to do the right thing, but he wants to also please the crowd. He was being a people pleaser, and it caused him to make a not so great decision to have Jesus crucified. Now, it's good now because, of course, it helps all of us now, because that was something that had to happen for us to receive our salvation. But the point is this. If you notice, the people, they could not accept Jesus as a king, as the Son of God, because they were not kingdom-minded. They were more focused on earthly things rather than the kingdom of God, because all they could think about was Caesar, their earthly king. But that's all he was an earthly king. He was just a man. Jesus was not just a man. He wasn't just a prophet. He wasn't just a healer. He's the Son of the living God. This is God in the flesh here. So this isn't just the King of the Jews. Jesus is the King of kings and Lord of lords. He's King of all. But they couldn't see the big picture because they, again, were not kingdom-minded. They could only focus on the things of this world. And so they made it out to be to where if you didn't fully support the decision to pick Caesar and to go against Jesus, you were basically making yourself out to be an enemy against Caesar. That's how they were trying to portray this. And Pilate didn't want to come across as an enemy to Caesar in the eyes of the people, because he wanted to please the people for his own sake. And so with that said, let me say this. Once again, as you band together and as you let God lead you, as you let Jesus lead you, or the person or people that God puts in the position to lead you in the right direction, you must understand that there will be people that will have something negative to say. They'll have something negative to say about you. They'll have something negative to say about your leader, even though they're doing the right thing. They'll always be naysayers, all because they are not as kingdom-minded as they believe they are. They are more focused on their own personal insecurities and their own fears of what their own little personal kings, their own little mini Adolf Hitlers in their life, they're scared of what they may do or say or think. So because of their own personal fears and insecurities, they will always make it be about picking a side when that's not what it's about. Well, I'm going to pick this person's side. I, you know, I can't think much of you and the people that are leading you. Yeah, y'all might be going in the right direction. Yeah, y'all might be fulfilling God's vision. But, you know, I can't offend this little mini Hitler in my life, even if it means yelling crucify, crucify at you or at your business or at your ministry or at your own personal growth. So this is something that you have to accept. It's a reality. These things will happen as you have your righteous leadership and as you band together with your other locusts. But here's the cool thing about being this locust. Go with me to Exodus chapter 10. Look at this with me real quick. Look at this. Exodus chapter 10. It says this, starting at verse 1. And the Lord said unto Moses, go in unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I might show these my signs before him, and that thou mayest tell in the ears of thy son and of thy son's son what things I have wrought in Egypt, and my signs which I have done among them, that ye may know how that I am the Lord. And Moses and Aaron came in unto Pharaoh and said unto him, thus saith the Lord God of the Hebrews, how long wilt thou refuse to humble thyself before thee? Let my people go, that they may serve me. Else if thou refuse to let my people go, behold, tomorrow will I bring the locusts into thy coast. So we know that many times God sent Moses and Aaron to go address Pharaoh, Pharaoh being the leader of the Egyptians. And they were sent to say to Pharaoh, let God's people go. Let God's people out of slavery. Let them go and do their own thing. So numerous times they kept going to Pharaoh, addressing Pharaoh, saying, let the people go. Let God's people go. And Pharaoh's heart continued to be hardened. He continued to deny the request. And what happened was every time this plague would hit, it would be different plagues for every time Pharaoh said no. On this particular occasion, they let it be known that if he says no, the plague that will occur will be a plague, or listen, a swarm of locusts on the coast. Now that might not seem like much. So what? Some locusts. Big deal. They're just some little critters. We'll just have a lot of them. So what? However, even though these locusts are little, and even though they seem harmless individually, and even though they look simple and harmless, they just look like a little old type of grasshopper, friendly little grasshopper. Look at what it says in verses 5 and 6. And they shall cover the face of the earth, that one cannot be able to see the earth. And they shall eat the residue of that which is escaped, which remaineth unto you from the hail, and shall eat every tree which groweth for you out of the field. And they shall fill thy houses, and the houses of all thy servants, and the houses of all the Egyptians, which neither thy fathers nor thy fathers' fathers have seen, since the day that they were upon the earth unto this day. And he turned himself and went out from Pharaoh. So he's saying, yeah, it might not seem like a big deal, just some little friendly locusts. But this plague, this swarm of locusts, when this occurs, first of all, you got to understand, it's not that it's just going to be a bunch of them and that's it in a particular area. Oh, no. There's going to be multitudes of these locusts. And they're not going to be in just one spot. They're going to cover your whole territory. They're going to cover the earth to where you really can't see much of anything. You can't really see the ground. You can't really see the trees. You can't really see your pyramids. You can't see much of anything because these locusts are going to completely cover everything. That's the first thing you have to know. But the next thing you have to know is that, listen, they are going to eat up the residue of it all. In other words, listen, these locusts, when they come in swarms, they're going to eat up your crops. They're going to eat up all your food before you get the chance to eat up all your food. They, listen, when you get enough of these locusts together in swarms, they will eat up crops. They will eat up things in the fields faster than you can get these things to grow. In other words, listen, these locusts, even though they may not seem like much individually, if this plague of locusts hits you, these locusts will pretty much basically cause a famine in the land. And that's saying something, because this is Egypt. This is a thriving land. This is a place that's got a lot going for it. This is a rich place. And so for all of your produce to be consumed at a faster rate than you can grow it, it's not going to be good for you at all. Your people will starve. Your people will begin to perish. You will have famine in this land. And finally, it'll get to a point where your homes will be filled with these locusts. These locusts are about to come and do you guys in. You'll have hell with them outside and out in your crops and in your everyday life. But then, to top it all off, when you finally decide to come home and lay your head to rest, those locusts will be flying around and crawling around and hopping and skipping all over the place in your home, on your floors, on your walls, on your bed, your resting places. They'll be everywhere, and you will not, no matter how much you try to swat at them, stomp on them, slap them around, you will not get rid of them, because they will continue to multiply. They will continue to consume everything until God is ready for it to be over. You need to submit to what God is saying unto you. Let the people go. Now, you got to stop and think about this. Now, I know this probably sounds a little silly, but when getting ready for this sermon, this is what played out in my head. I was imagining what it would be like, and maybe it didn't play out like this, but this is just entertain me for a moment. Let's just go with this. It was like I was imagining in my mind heaven, and God's on the throne, and there are some locusts in a little sectioned off area of heaven for locusts. They're out there in locust land just doing their own little thing. And God says, come here, locusts, come here. I want to talk to y'all about something. And the locusts, they're gathering around the throne. I know it's silly, but just bear with me. And God is like, you know, I know people might not think much of you. Other animals might not think much of you. They look at you like a little pushover. They don't think much of you. They think you're just little nuisances. You're just a little annoyance to everybody. You're just here. You got no purpose. You're just here. But I want to use y'all. I'm going to use y'all for my glory. And then it's like I can imagine the locusts as being like, what? God's going to use us? We're just locusts. We're nothing. But God's going to use us, you know, in their own little locust language. You know, I know it sounds silly, but just go with me on this. And they're looking around like, what? Let's listen to this. We got to hear God's plan. And God's like, I'm going to use y'all greatly. No one thinks much of you, but when I get done using y'all, people are going to think twice about you guys when y'all come together in bands. You'll be unstoppable. I'm going to use you guys to be a plague. And it's like I can hear the locusts being like, whoa, what? We're going to be a plague? We're going to cause some havoc? We're going to wreak some havoc with the enemies of God on the earth? You mean we're going to get to come up against Pharaoh, the Pharaoh himself? What? Uh-oh, party time. party in Locust Land. Eric, right? Got the turntables. Eric, got the DJ. You know, they're excited in little Locust Land up there in heaven. Their time is coming to have their moment in the spotlight, to show what they can do, to show that even though they're little, when they come together in bands with the godly leadership and the godly direction, they can make a difference. And so finally God says, okay, go. And they get to come down to earth and they just start swarming the Egyptian territory. I know that sounds silly, but I just wanted to share that. But that's the thoughts that I want you to have in your mind about this. Understand, guys, that you may feel like a little. You may seem like a little in the eyes of people, but when God uses you, when God bands you together with other little people, he can make big things happen. He can bring your enemies to their knees. He can prepare a table for you in the midst of your enemies, and they'll have to watch you eat. That's what happened. Them locusts went out there and they ate. They ate, like I said, they ate faster than they could produce. And so, God prepared a table for the locusts in front of the enemies of God. You know, that really for real happened. It really played out like that. But anyway, moving on, going back to Proverbs chapter 30, the last verse of this sermon, this study, it says this: the spider taketh hold with her hands and is in king's palaces. A spider is a creature that is known for just showing up at any moment. You'll be sitting in your home, in your room somewhere, and all of a sudden, you see a spider walking across the floor. You see a spider walking up the wall. You see a spider slowly making its way down. It's got a string that is attached to something on the ceiling, or, you know, a lamp, or a, you know, a ceiling fan blade or something. And it slowly just, as it makes that string that it uses to create a web, as it makes that string, it slowly just starts making its way down, just making its way down. And sometimes the only way you know it is because you'll be sitting there looking at TV, and next thing you know, you'll just see it out of your peripheral vision. You'll see this spider slowly just making its way down right beside your head, and you look over and you're like, whoa. You know, it just catches you off guard. And the spider's just like, hello. And he just keeps on making his way down, like, whatever, I'm in your house, but whatever, no big deal. You know, you couldn't stop me from coming in here. You don't know how I got in here, so you might as well let me stay. You know, it's almost like spiders have that mentality. They're small, but because they're small, it's easy for them to access things and places. So these little spiders have a way of ending up in king's palaces. You may feel small, but it's your advantage to get into mighty places. It's your way of getting out of the pit and going into the palace. Go with me to Esther. Just looking at chapter 1, starting at verse 10, it says this: on the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine — these people just love being merry with wine, don't they — he commanded Mehuman and Biztha and Harbona, Bigtha and Abagatha, Zethar and Carcass. That's got to suck to have Carcass for a name. But anyway, even Bigtha, like, you know, like if you're a heavy set person, somebody might nickname you Bigtha, like when they call heavyset people Big Bertha. Anyway, whatever. I'm going to move on. The seven chamberlains that served in the presence of Ahasuerus the king, to bring Vashti the queen before the king with the crown royal, to shew the people and the princes her beauty, for she was fair to look on. But the queen Vashti refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned in him. So what we have here is we have a king, King Ahasuerus, And he wants to set up this little event where he wants to bring in his wife, Queen Vashti, and show her off, parade her around, show her beauty. And you would think that Vashti would be flattered, but instead she has this stuck up attitude about it. She decides she doesn't want to show up, and it makes the king very angry. What ends up happening is some people get with the king and they're discussing this matter, and a suggestion is made to the king to just do away with his current queen and find a new queen. He agrees to this idea. And so these people of the castle or the palace, they go out into different provinces, areas of the land to try to seek women out, almost like an audition almost, to seek women out to come in to get to know the king, or for the king to get to know them rather, so that the king can find a new queen amongst these people. So when you go over to chapter 2, it says this. Starting at verse 15. Now when the turn of Esther, the daughter of Abihail, the uncle of Mordecai, who had taken her for his daughter, was come to go in unto the king, she required nothing but what Haggai, the king's chamberlain, the keeper of the women, appointed. And Esther obtained favor in the sight of all them that looked upon her. So Esther was taken unto King Ahasuerus into the house royal in the 10th month, which is the month of Tebeth, in the 7th year of his reign. And the king loved Esther above all the women, and she obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal crown upon her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. So Esther, a woman named Esther, finds favor with the king. She is crowned the new queen. But the interesting thing about Esther is this. Esther, you could say, was probably little in the eyes of many people. Esther had lost her parents, and her uncle Mordecai took her in, adopted her in as his own. So here's somebody who doesn't have a lot of family, somebody who has been taken in by somebody, and she doesn't really seem to have much going for her at the moment. But she finds favor with this king, and she goes from being someone outside of the palace, a little possibly feeble woman outside of the palace, to quickly becoming the queen in the palace, having great favor with the king, even setting up meetings with the king in ways that other people wouldn't be able to just have access to the king to say, hey, let's sit down and have a talk. She would be able to set up little meetings with the king and have discussions with him. She had such a favor. Please understand that this is an example of the spider and of the little person. You may be little, but you have a way of being able to slide in through the cracks that other people can't, to enter into the palace and find great favor. Not only that, but kind of like how they say, don't forget where you came from, don't forget who helped you. Esther made a way for Mordecai. And for all the Jews, Mordecai being a Jew, for all the Jews to be welcomed by this king, to not have the king's people coming up against the Jews anymore. She made a way for the people of God and for Mordecai to enter in to this palace and to this kingdom, to be a part of it as well. The interesting thing about that is this. When I looked up what Mordecai meant, because of course, as I've said many times, names have meanings in the Bible. just like words have special meanings, sometimes names will have special meanings. There are a couple of definitions of Mordecai, one being worshiper of Mars, but the other meaning of the name Mordecai is little man. His name, oh goodness, his name can mean little man. So you have Esther, who originally was probably very little, very insignificant in the eyes of the people, but like the spider, she has made her way into the palace. And the crazy thing is, she does not forget who helped her arrive at this palace, who gave her good advice and good tips for things that she should do whenever she addressed the king. She brought him in, and it turns out that he also, according to his own name, is a little person. Now you understand the significance of being a little person, making your way into a palace, and being little and being willing to band together with other little people. Mordecai, even though she was just little old Esther, Mordecai thought enough of her to say, you know what? Let me take you over here. I want you to have this opportunity. How loving he was. He took this girl in when he didn't have to. He took her in, took care of her, and spoke positiveness over her, because there's power in the tongue. We have life and death in the power of the tongue. He spoke well over her and said, go. You can do it. Go. I support you. I'll back you up. Even though you don't have anybody else backing you up, I'm going to back you up in this, and I want to see you succeed and find favor with the king. So he took her in and gave her opportunity and gave good advice and stood outside the palace doors, walking around, pacing around, making sure everything was good, keeping tabs on her. And sure enough, as she made her way in, like a spider going through the cracks, she easily makes her way to the top. Finds favor with the king, makes a way for Mordecai to come in, saves her people. She was appointed and created for such a time as this. And she went from being a little person, a little old feeble Esther, to helping out the little man herself. So we see someone helping a little person, and that little person becomes a big person who turns right around and helps who is now the little person become an even bigger person themselves. And so let me pause and say this, because I'm talking to some Esthers out there. But let me pause and say this to some people listening. You might not be the Esther, but you might be the Mordecai. There are some people listening who might be the Mordecai. And maybe God has tried to place it on your heart to go after that Esther, to go after that person, to say, you know what? No one else is favoring that Esther. No one else thinks much of that Esther. That Esther has been abandoned by many. She's been rejected by many. She's been left behind by many. And she doesn't really seem to have much going for her right now. But I'm going to step up to the plate. People might view me as a little man, but I'm going to step up and I'm going to be a big man. And I'm going to grab a hold of little Esther, and I'm going to listen. I'm going to care for her, and I'm going to make a way for her, and I'm going to watch out for her and speak an encouraging word. And listen, tell her what she needs to hear. Give her the good advice. Give her the pep talk. Let her know she can do it. I'm going to help her get to the palace. And listen, even though I'm not going to expect anything in return, even though I'm not going to hold the fact that I helped her over her head, I know that God has put the right heart into this Esther, that if she makes it, when she makes it, she'll turn right around and pull me right on up by the bootstraps as well. There's some Mordecais out there right now who God is moving upon you to help the Esthers, to help the Tamars, to help those who need to be helped, who probably should have already been helped a long time ago. And maybe he's just now, listen, putting it into your heart to help, or maybe he's tried to get you to do something way back when, and maybe you were too ashamed or too concerned about what people thought to do anything. But right now is not the time to hesitate. Right now is not the time to be an Absalom. This is not the time to be, listen, someone who just wants to sit back and spectate. This is the moment to do something powerful. Not be selfish, but selfless. Because as you become selfless to help someone, God will give them favor, you favor, and you'll end up in a higher position than what you originally were. Stop worrying about your position. Stop worrying about your title. Stop worrying about your rank. Stop looking at it from the point of view of, well, things seem to be going good. Things feel good right now for me. I've had some rough patches in life, and so now that I've got my foot in the door, I just want to be comfortable. Listen, this is your moment. This is what you've been prepped for. You might not even know it, but this is what you've been waiting for. This is what God has, listen, set in place for you. And if you would but just hearken and say, you know what, let me be the one to step up to the plate when nobody else will, God may just surprise you. Just as the blessings will start to flow down from the king to Esther, they flow down to you. And the king's heart is merry. Come on, we've been talking about the merry hearts. The king's heart has been made merry with wine. And he's extra merry thanks to Esther. And Esther's gonna be merry because Esther is just happy to be where she is now. After what she's gone through, after the abandonment that she's gone through, after feeling little for all the years that she's felt like nothing, rest assured, Esther will be thankful to be finally out of the pit and into the palace. So you've got some merry folks that if you would but just do your part and quit worrying about what the folks around you think, if you would but do what God has put it in your heart to do, you will be mind blown how the blessings will just flow right on down to you. You won't have people holding stuff over your head no more. You won't be made to feel like a robot, like a clone, like a toy, like a puppet on a string. You'll actually get to feel like a big man and not a little man that people have made you out to be, Mordecai. This is not only a time for some Esthers and some Tamars. This is the time for some Mordecais. No longer can you stand back and be an Absalom. Oh, boy. No, let me say that again. No longer can you stand back and stand by and watch with your arms folded, spectating and waiting to see what happens next. No longer. This is your opportunity to step up to the plate, to become the Mordecai. And then you go from being the Mordecai or the little man to being big man on campus. This is a special time for some people. But I want to wrap this up with one last place to take you to. That's Mark chapter 5. Now, again, it said in Proverbs that it's a spider that not only makes its way into palaces, but it says that the spider holds on with her hands. And there's someone else in the Bible who she was little, she was feeble. She's known for her weakness or illness that made her weak. And this weak, little feeble woman held on. Oh, goodness. Held on. Held on with her hand and didn't let go until she received the blessing. Mark chapter 5. We know this story. Starting at verse 25, it says, "And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse, when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, 'If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be made whole.' And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague." Oh, here we are with the theme of plagues again. I love how all this stuff just keeps tying into each other. But moving on, verse 30. "And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, 'Who touched me?' And his disciples said unto him, 'Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?' And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, 'Daughter,'" here it is, "'daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague.'" We know the story of the woman with the issue of blood. For years she had been plagued with an illness, and it made her weak, and it wore her out. And she was almost nothing, literally. She was almost to a place where she could have probably died. And so she's weak, and she doesn't have much going for her. And people don't really want to help her or assist her. And all her money, her finances are depleted because of the physicians that she's gone to. It's even to the point where, listen, it's to the point where she got worse and worse in her condition instead of getting better and better. The money got depleted just like she did. And it got to a place where it seemed like all hope was lost for her. But Jesus came on to the scene, and she decided to step out on faith and say, "If I would take my hand," like that spider in Proverbs who holds on with her hand to enter into palaces, to enter into kingdoms. Oh, here we go. The woman reaches out for the hem of Jesus's garment, receiving power, receiving virtue, receiving healing. And Jesus turns about to see what's going on. Something spectacular has happened. He's got all these people around him, the disciples and the crowds. They're touching him, they're thronging him, they're brushing up against him. But when this woman touches him, he turns himself about because he knows that power has left out of him. And so when he asks who it is that has touched him, and the woman speaks out, and he sees the faith in this woman, not only does Jesus say that your faith has made thee whole, check this out, he says, "Daughter, your faith has made thee whole." And the awesome thing about that, ladies and gentlemen, is this: if Jesus is king, going back to him being king over Caesar again, all this stuff keeps tying in, all the verses I keep going to, they keep tying in together. If Jesus is not only a king, but he's king of kings, we see just how royal he is. He's royalty. So if he addresses this woman and calls her daughter, that now makes her a princess, and that now makes her a part of a kingdom. She's now royalty, just like Esther. She is now, listen, someone who, like the spider, used her hands to hold on and slide her way in to the spiritual palace that is being a Christian. So I'm simply here to say to some folks listening right now, reach your hand out, grab on to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the soon returning one true King. Tamar's rise up, Esther's rise up, women with the issue of blood and other issues rise up. This is your time. Absalom's, time to get over yourself. Absalom's, time to grow up. Absalom's, time to start loving and caring about yourself and having some self-worth about yourself so that you can care enough about Tamar's and the others that you should have cared about a long time ago. Step up to the Mordecai plate. Be that Mordecai that you need to be to help usher in the Esther. Because as you push her forward, you get to go forward right along with her. Oh, goodness. With that said, I hope this message helps some people. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this word. I believe that it has touched some people. I believe that this will be a wake-up call for some people, that people will feel loved by their own selves, even when no one else loves them. They'll love themselves, they'll love you, Lord, and they will learn to stick up for themselves and each other. I give you the praise, the glory, and honor, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.